Morning, church.
What a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord another day. And if you could please, we got more people coming in here. Stand for the reading of God's word, to those that you can stand. And I will be reading for you Psalms 121 in its entirety. And it reads, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is my keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and forevermore. May the Lord add a blessing to the reason doers of his holy word. Amen. Please join me in a word of prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts, thanking you for another day. Father God, a day that wasn't promised to us, but you saw fit to allow us to be here one more day. And Father God, we pray that we make something out of this day that we can tell someone about a living Savior. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to be here. Father God, ask your blessing upon the congregation. Ask your blessing upon our pastor today, Father God, as he brings the word. And Father God, I pray that the word don't fall on deaf ears. And Father God, that somebody can come out saying, what must I do to be saved? Father God, ask for forgiveness of anything that we might have done that wasn't pleasing to you, Father God. Father God, we just pray for situations. We pray for marriages. We pray for love for one another, Father God. We pray for more laborers in this church, Father God. Father God, we just pray for guidance. Father God, we just pray for your leadership, Father God. And Father God, as we go, we ask you to give us the strength to endure this day. Father God, tomorrow is not promised to us, Father God. But Father God, we ask you to allow us to do something in your name today. Father God, we love you and we thank you for all you do for us. And all I can say is hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah. These are our prayers I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. Thank God we're here today, and we're going to do your all I need. I don't know about you, but he's all I need.
Yes.
You know, sisters and brothers are okay. Mom and daddy is okay. But he is all that you need. All that you need. So if you want to stand with us and sing, clap your hands, sing in your seat, it's good.
Your rivers flow through me.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
Every breath you
every
breathe,
breath you breathe through me.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
Let your rivers flow
Let
through
your
me.
Rivers flow through
You're
me.
All
You're
I need.
All I need.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
I'll
draw all men to me.
You're my closest
friend.
And you will have my being.
Have my being.
I want to draw all the dark closer.
I need
you. That if I
be lifted,
I'll draw all
men to me.
You're my closest friend. And you will have my being.
You're my being.
I want to
draw closer.
I need to draw closer to you.
All I need.
Every breath you breathe,
every breath you breathe through me.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
Let your rivers flow
Let
through me.
Let your rivers flow through me.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
Every breath you
every
breathe,
breath
through
you breathe through me.
You're all I need.
You're all I need.
Let your rivers flow
Let your
through
rivers
me.
Rivers flow through me.
You're all I need.
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 We got a war cry.
Oh, 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 oh.
When I first heard it, I thought they was talking about a bomb like they doing in Ukraine, but it's a bomb, B-A-L-M. The bomb is like a salve to heal your body, to heal your wounds and your sorrows. And you know what? Who that bomb is?
Jesus.
Yes. He's the only one that can take away your sorrow, your grief, your pain. So just join us as we sing healing.
Don't be discouraged. Joy comes in the morning. Know that God is nigh. Stand still. God is Don't be discouraged.
You know, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Know that God is nigh. He never leaves nor forsakes. He's right there.
Is nigh.
Just stand still.
Stand still.
And look up.
And look up.
Because you know what? God is going to show up.
God is going to show up. He is standing by.
There's healing for your sorrow.
There's healing for your sorrow.
Healing for your pain.
Healing for your pain.
There's healing for your spirit.
Healing for your spirit.
There's shelter from the rain.
There's shelter from the rain.
Lord, send a healing.
Lord, send your healing.
For this we know.
For this we know. There is a balm in Gilead. For there's a balm in Gilead. For there's a balm in Gilead to heal the soul.
There's healing for your sorrow.
There's healing for your sorrow.
And there's healing for your pain.
Healing for your pain.
There's healing for your spirit.
Healing for your spirit.
And there's shelter from the rain.
There's shelter from the rain.
Lord, send the healing.
Lord, send the healing.
For this we know.
For this we know.
There is
a balm in Gilead.
He was wounded for our transgression.
Yes. There is a balm in Gilead.
And by his stripes we are healed. Yes, we are.
For there's a balm in Gilead to heal the soul.
To heal your soul.
To heal the soul.
Whatever you're going through, Jesus can fix it.
To heal the soul.
Yes, Lord.
To heal the soul.
Just know that you can depend on Jesus.
To heal the soul. To heal the soul.
Good morning, church. I'm Sister CJ, and I hope all of you are blessed this morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. I just want to talk to you briefly again about prayer and fasting. We talked about that last Sunday, and tomorrow is actually when we start, so I'm sure you guys are really surprised. I just can't see it on your face. You're excited about it. And it is a little overwhelming. Like I said last week, it's a 21-day fast, but you have to make it your own between you and your personal relationship with God and what you need to fast and what you need to pray about so we can pray all together as one body. Also, I wanted to say God will take our problems as we fast and pray in humility. Our battle becomes God's. And that is 2 Chronicles 20 and 15. And there's many things that you can fast from, like I mentioned last week, not just food, but maybe sweets or chocolate or social media, television, computer, things like that, because I know a lot of us have pre-existing medical conditions, so we do have to eat. So again, that's why I say you just have to make it your own so you'll be successful. So you have to be realistic of what you can and cannot do. And also, when we fast, we have a deeper desire, a more intimate and powerful relationship with the Lord, which is something that I know I need every day because I sin and fall short every day. And I always say I would never ask anyone to do something that I would not do myself. So, and also, maybe you need a break away from the bondages that have been holding you hostage. So you need to maybe pray about that. And maybe for myself also, I need to pray to be broken so I can be healed by God, so I can be right. So I just want to be transparent with everyone. You know, I have my issues that I deal with every day. It's hard to live in this world and be no part of it. It's just part of being human. But it doesn't mean that we don't love the Lord. And to piggyback on what Reverend Cooper preached on yesterday, the generosity that God gives us, for me, it's the least I can do to sacrifice something to show my love for him. And also, one last thing, I fast every week. I fast one day a week, and I've been doing it for years now because it's just become a lifestyle for me. But there was a day I decided to fast negative thinking, and you'd be amazed how much you catch yourself. So I'm just throwing that out there as well. But there's so many different things that you can fast from. So I just look forward to hearing about everyone's journey and just keep God first. And all those times that you don't fast and you give up something, or you do fast and you give up something, fill that time with prayer. And we'll have more stuff in the bulletin and more things to keep you inspired to stay on the track for that. So I love you all. God bless.
Good morning, people of Christ, Missionary Baptist Church, family and friends. My name is Tamika Ward, and I'm part of the finance team. If you would like to give your offering, tithes, or donation to the church, we have three simple ways. Number one, you can go to our website at pocbaptist.org. Scroll down to click on Give Online and follow the simple directions. Option two, you can text us at 209-822-2009. You can also mail a check or money order, no cash please, to 11473 West Larch Road, Tracy, California, 95304. You can also drop your tithes or offering to the church by calling us at 209-833-7258 and we'll meet you here. Thank you and God bless.
still. The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger. Heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, till at last she kneeled before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard as she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. I spent my days pouring out my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I'd found, until the day Jesus came to me. He healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. So I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair, my hair. You see, you weren't there the night that he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. You don't know the cost of the oil. Hey, you don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box, my box.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You don't know the cost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Good morning, church. I thank God for his goodness, and I'm appreciative of the presence of each and every one of you this morning. What day is this? This is the day. And I will rejoice, and I'll let nothing, nobody, disturb my peace of mind, as he will keep you perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusted in thee. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. Amen. Trust in the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I take time. I'd like to welcome our visitors here this morning. Amen. You are welcome. If you would like to stand, and give your name, you're welcome. If not, look, I'm not here to put nobody on blast. I'm gonna keep it moving. All right, okay, ain't nobody stood up. All right, it's all good. Okay. Brother Walls. Amen. All right. Amen. Your niece and nephew. All right. Well, good morning, brother-in-law. That's brother-in-law. Amen. Amen. Good morning, niece and nephew. Amen. Thank you for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Amen. Amen. There is a word from the Lord this morning. Did anybody bring their Bibles this morning? Anybody, come on, anybody brought their Bible? Amen, your electronic device, amen. All right, amen, bring that word with you. Amen, like I said, ain't nothing like having that Bible. You know, you got these electronic devices, amen. What else you got on there? Pictures and movies. Amen. iTunes and all that. Amen. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. We will be coming from the gospel as recorded by Luke. Luke, the seventh chapter. For the sake of, I don't want my good spoken evil of, we just going to read verses 36 through 39. Now, if you want to be blessed, all right, this whole story, it goes from verse 36 to verse 50. So in your private time, go home and read the rest of that text. And after we get through reading verses 36 to 39, keep your Bibles open, because I'm going to hit a few points within that story. Amen. Amen, amen. So we'll be reading Luke chapter 7, verse 36 through 50. We'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible, amen. Now, we have some commas, some periods, maybe a semicolon there, amen. Take your time. All right, let's not rush. Amen. So we're going to read in unison the New American Standard Bible. All right, verse 36 through verse 39. Keep me in prayer. Amen. And it reads this. Now, was requesting him to dine with him. Amen. God bless you. I'd like to tag this text with your prayers, but above all, with God's presence. Daring devotion. You may be seated. Daring devotion. Daring devotion. Father God, we come in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, we come humbling and submitting ourselves unto you. Lord, I just want to say thank you, Master, for sparing my life. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, that it is you that dwells deep down within. You remind me you will never leave me nor forsake me. Lord, I thank you, Lord. I come not asking for anything, but I want to thank you for everything. I thank you for another day's journey. Lord, I'm glad about it. I thank you, Lord, that you opened up my eyes and I still had a roof over my head and a floor underneath my feet. I just want to thank you, Lord, for a reasonable portion of health and strength. Lord, I don't want to take you for granted. I don't want to take your blessings for granted. So I got to thank you that I was able to put my own clothes on this morning. Thank you, Lord, that I was able to put one foot in front of another. Thank you, Lord, when I went to my cupboard, if I wanted something to eat, there was food there. And it's only because of your grace. Grace woke me up this morning. Your grace started me along the way. Grace, I'm clothed in my right mind. Lord, a mind to come and worship you this morning and give you a little praise and honor and glory. Lord, I pray for every individual and every household that is represented here this morning. And again, I thank you that you're omniscient, God. You know all about it. You are a God that you look at our hearts. You look at the inside and not the outside. You know our pain. You know our struggle. You know our setbacks. You know what we're in the need of. And I thank you that you are a God that will supply our each and every need. I thank you that you are a doctor in a sick room. Somebody needs healing this morning. I thank you that you are the master of the sea and you'll speak peace, be still. I thank you, Jehovah Shalom. We give you praise this morning. I'm praying over those in the hospital room, praying for those behind prison bars. Praying for those that are walking out the street calling your name unholy, those that need to be here, touch them right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Now it's me, oh Lord. standing in the need of prayer. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh, Lord, you are my strength, and you are my redeemer. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Daring devotion. The story of a prostitute living on the streets of Chicago. It was a frigid, blistering evening when she stumbled into a homeless shelter. She was cold, desperate, hungry, and not able to pay for food for herself and her two-year-old daughter. She was greatly warmed and greeted by the director of the facility. And through her tears, she began to tell her story. Her life was completely a mess. And yet over the last few weeks, she had been doing things that even she thought were unimaginable. She confessed that she was selling her daughter, 2 years of age, 1 hour at a time to men of that city. She could make more money from the 1 hour renting her daughter for sexual favors than she could make in an entire night from turning tricks all night long. She knew it was wrong, but she did not know another way of how to pay for her drug addiction. The conversation had not gone very long before the director of the facility realized that he was now legally liable. He had to report such a grievous child abuse. Before he wrapped up the conversation, he asked her, "Have you ever thought of going to church?" He said he would never forget the shock that came across her face. She said, "Church? Church? Why would I go there? I already feel bad about myself, and they, church folk, would just make me feel worse." When I read the story on one hand, and I read the gospel of Jesus Christ on the other hand, there is a great discrepancy. It appears to me that these are the type of people that flocked to Jesus in the days of the first century. And these are the type of people who would not set foot in the building that bears his name. And I wonder, why is that so? Throughout the Bible, Jesus is regarded as a friend to sinners, no matter what that sin might be. Jesus, he was never too high, he was never too mighty to reach out to the poor and the lonely. Jesus, he always attracted those who were desperate for him. The truth of the gospel is evident by the testimony of the transformed lives of the redeemed. A daring devotion. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw Somebody need to go to verse 36. Jesus received an invitation, there you go, to go to a person's house that did not think very much of him. One of the Pharisees has requested him to dine with him. Brothers and sisters, think it not strange when you receive an invitation from people that may not like you. Sometimes they just want to study you. Sometimes they are just merely trying to find out what makes you tick. Sometimes it is just something about you that they don't like, and they just want to affirm that feeling. Don't let it shock you to discover that everybody that invites you to eat, it does not mean that they are in love with you. Oh, I know what I'm talking about. There was a story of a woman, and she had six husbands. She had six husbands. Five of them she killed when they ate her soup. Five of them died because she ate her soup. She shot the sixth one. Why? He wouldn't eat the soup. Come on, Sister Mary. You know that's funny. So what am I saying? When you invited to someone's house, be careful. And don't eat the soup. Whatever the case may be, this Pharisee invited Jesus to come to his house? It says, and now one of the Pharisees was requesting Jesus to dine with him. And Jesus entered the Pharisee's house and he reclined at the table. Jesus was at home at this Pharisee named Simon. Now, we don't know why Simon the Pharisee invited Jesus to dine with him. Why, look, the Pharisees hated Jesus. Jesus didn't cater to their crowd, and occasionally Jesus said things that would ruffle their feathers, and he would challenge their man-made rules. They didn't like him. But they're not sure how to handle him. They tried ignoring Jesus. They tried publicly opposing Jesus. They tried entrapping Jesus in doctrinal disputes. But nothing seems to work. One of the Pharisees was requesting him to eat with him. Jesus entered into the Pharisee's house. Jesus is in the house. Now, understand, first century is that when you go to eat, that the table may be only 18 inches from the floor. So they would have nice plush pillows around the table. And when you sat at the table to recline, you would have one elbow here and you would reach for the food with your other hand, but your feet would be pointed behind you. Why would your feet be behind you? Because you understand that at that time period, there was unpaved roads. And not only did the people that were wearing sandals on those roads, the animals walked on those roads also. So your feet would be dusty and muddy and no telling what you've been stepping in. So Jesus invited to this dinner. Now, not only Jesus was invited, but the doors would be open And those that were not invited could come in, but they would not sit at the table. They would have to stand along the wall. They would not interrupt the dinner, but they were just there to see important people and to hear the conversations. Give me verse 37 here. And there was a woman in that city who was a sinner. Now, many theologians, I'm constantly trying to help you, be careful with the commentaries you read, because some may try to say that this text here was about Mary of Bethany. You know, that was Lazarus' sister. There's some that may say that this text was about Mary Magdalene. But you got to study the scripture. Amen. And for the sake of time, amen, you go home and study, come to Bible study, and we'll talk about it. If you really want to know. But look, the writer did not give her name. It said there was a woman. I believe this, that the author of this text, which is God, told the writer, which is Luke, I want her to be anonymous. Anonymous for a purpose. He doesn't tell us her name because he wants you and I to identify with her. He wants you and I to identify with her because she could be you with your saved self. She could be your sister. She could be your aunt. She could be someone that is related to you. This woman is anonymous because Luke is inviting us into the story. Said that she was a sinner. Luke does not tell us her sin. We can assume her sin. You could have the same sin. You could have a different sin now. But regardless, we should be at the feet of Jesus. When she learned that he was reclining at the table, she was a sinner. And I don't know that you know about this woman, but understand this. She is your sister. Why? Because we all were born into sin and shaped into iniquity. Huh? She was the type of woman, because it is said that they assumed that she was a prostitute, that she was a streetwalker, she was a woman of the night. She was that type of woman that a wife didn't want her husband to socialize with. She was the type of woman that a mother didn't want her daughter to follow. She is the type of woman, amen, that if she came walking in this church, one of the mothers could go get a deacon and say, you need to take her out of here. She learned that Jesus was in the house. She didn't come to see the Pharisees. She didn't come to see what kind of food they was eating. She didn't come just to show up and eat. She came because she heard Jesus was in the house. And I wish, and somebody here this morning, you didn't come here just to hear the praise team. You didn't come in here to see the praise dancer. You didn't come in here to see what so-and-so is wearing. I came in here. It's is Jesus in this house. It's Jesus in the house. I love y'all, but I don't come here looking for you. No, because you may not show up. It's Jesus in the house. I want to share that that is a good reason to show up here. I came here to hear a word from him. I came here this morning to feel his presence. I came in here this morning that he would talk to me. I came in for no other reason but to worship and to lift up the name of Jesus. But another thing, at the bottom, she brought an alabaster, some say vial, box of perfume. What am I saying? When she came, she didn't come empty-handed. She did not come empty-handed. You know how some of us, I left my wallet in another suit. Lord, let me move on. This perfume, it was a very expensive perfume. This perfume, it was worth a person's yearly salary. My brothers and sisters, you cannot worship without a sacrifice. She not only, you can't work as worship without a sacrifice, but she came and she gave all that she had. She didn't come before she got to church, she didn't pour some of the perfume out. She gave it all. Says, give me 38. And standing behind him, she was at the feet of Jesus. That is a good place to be, at the feet of Jesus. No matter who you are, no matter what your sin is, you need to be at the feet of Jesus. There is some benefits at the feet of Jesus. There are some blessings that you can receive at the feet of Jesus. When you get in trouble, you can find security at his feet. There is grace at the feet of Jesus. She began weeping and wet her feet with her tears. Not just a few drops, but they were just pouring out and pouring out like rain. And I don't know why. I like what the song said this morning, that the room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. Why was she there at the feet of Jesus? Maybe she was there with a repentant spirit. Do you remember the time when you first came to Jesus, how you humbled and how you submitted yourself and how you poured out yourself, and all you could think about is your past sins, and you could think about, I'm not worthy to be here, but I'm so glad I'm at his feet. I can remember, I'm just pouring out, Lord, forgive me for my sins. Worshiping with my own tears, I couldn't stop crying. Lord, I'm your child. She's just weeping in the tears. She felt so much pain.
And you can hear the folks whispering in the background saying that there's no place for her kind here. But she still came through her shame until at last she kneeled before his feet. No one knows what you've been through. No one knows your sorrow. No one knows your disappointment. No one knows your lonely night. No one knows your cheery night. No one knows when you're pacing the floor all night. But Jesus. She said, I spent many days of my life without measure. You don't know the cost of this oil in this alabaster box. To worship, it's going to cost you. It's going to cost you to worship with a sacrifice. She went on and she's by demonstrating this love for him, pouring out, praying that he would forgive me. Her eyes were bloodshot from the tears. Can you see her makeup running down her face like a waterfall? Why did she leave that wall to come to the feet of Jesus? Maybe it was desperation. Because desperation leads to devotion. And as she cried in her tears, she let down her hair. And women of that day would not let their hair down. But she let her hair down. And it don't matter what somebody else say. To dry Jesus' feet with her hair. She bowed down and she was worshiping him the best that she knew how. But then look at verse 39. The Pharisee who had invited him, he saw this. He said to himself, he didn't say it out loud. He said to himself, if this man was a prophet, he would know who and what sort of person this woman is. And he's allowing her to touch him. Simon, this Pharisee, this legalistic, this self-righteous person, he wanted to identify this woman by her sin. And I just want to share, those same words echo today in God's house. If a young lady walks in here and she has holes in her jeans, or if her tight top is cut too low, what is she doing here? If you only knew. The same thing goes on today. But I'm telling you, Jesus will allow you to touch him. If you just touch the hem of his garment. If I can just be in his presence. And he went on. Let me verse 40. This is what I love about Jesus. Jesus knew, Simon didn't know that Jesus was omniscient. He said it to himself, right? Lord have mercy. And Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to say to you. I could just see one of them. got something to say to you. You know, it's good to have somebody to stand up for you. It's good to have someone to stand by your side. The Lord took up for this woman. Well, let me tell you something. When your relationship with Jesus Christ, when people talk about you, it is good to have someone to stand up for you. When people lie on you, when people gossip about you, it is good to have somebody to stand by your side. When people say all kind of evil things about you, when folks put your business in the street, it is good. Well, I love that, bro. Let him praise to stand up. Jesus said to the Pharisees, you invited me to your house, but you failed. You did not make me feel welcome. As a custom, you didn't give me any water to wash my feet. In those days when they greeted one another, you did not greet me with the kiss. And in those customs when a visitor come to eat, you did not anoint my head with oil. But this woman, she came with an expensive perfume. This woman, she came kissing my feet. It is good to have somebody to stand up for you. As you continue to read this text, I'm just going to brief outline. Jesus told the Pharisee a story. Verse 41, I'm going to give you a little bit. He said, a money lender had two debtors. Now, one owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Now, that 500, what it equals to was 500 days of labor. That's what he owed. That's almost 2 years. The other one owed 50 days of labor, and that is almost 2 months. And neither one of them could pay the debt. So the money lender said, I forgive you. And the debt is canceled. So Jesus, he turned, give me 44, jump there right quick. He asked Simon, well, who would be more gracious? He said, the one that owed the more. Yes, you're right, Simon. Jesus turned to that woman and he said, do you see this woman? Do you see this woman? Simon, you have something to learn from this woman. Oh, yeah, I know you're a big shot. You're a shot caller. Yeah, and I know you're a Pharisee. I know you're a highly religious person, but you can learn from this woman. Do you see this woman? This woman who is forgiven much. Because she is forgiven much, she loves much. But the woman was not forgiven because of her love. Rather, she loved because she was forgiven. And the one that is forgiven little, he loves little. If you know you have been forgiven much, then you will love much. Jump to 47 right quick. For this reason, I say to you, her sins, which are many. Remember, she was a prostitute. She had many sins and have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. It's good to have someone to love you. It is good for someone to come from heaven down just for you. Jesus loves me so much that he went to Calvary's cross. Jesus loves me so, I got to make it personal. He loves me so much that he allowed them to put nails in his hand. Jesus, he loved me so much, he allowed them to put nails in his feet. Jesus loved me so much, he allowed them to pierce him in his side. Jesus loved me so much, as he hung on that cross, he gave up the ghost and he died. Jesus loved me so much that they buried him in a borrowed tomb. Jesus loved me so much that early third day Sunday morning, he got up with all power, heaven and earth in his hand. Jesus loved me so much. Do you know that Jesus loves you? I'm so glad. I'm so glad he died for me. I am so glad that when I go to bed at night, I'm knowing that he loves me. I'm so glad when he wakes me up in the morning, I know that he loves me. I am so glad when I'm riding down the street, I know that he loves me, because he never leaves me alone. He never forsakes me. He walks with me. He talks with me. And he tells me I'm his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there. Like no ever, ever known. He loves me so much, and I love him. I love Jesus. I'm in love with Jesus. And if you know that you have been forgiven much, then you will love much. But understand this, my brothers and sisters, we are not saved by Jesus' love. It is by grace that you are saved, through faith. You don't believe me? Go to verse 50 right quick. Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. It is your faith, it is your belief, it is your trust that what Jesus did on Calvary's cross, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe that God is raising from the dead, yes, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, but the world is still in sin. It is grace. Grace is the love that paid the price. And that price was his only begotten son. This woman was not forgiven because of her love. Rather, she loved. Because she loved, she was forgiven. Question, how desperate are you? How desperate are you for this amazing grace of God? Question, how much peace do you have in your life? Question, how much joy do you have in your life? How much peace do you have with yourself, with your family, with your friends, with your coworkers, with your neighbors? How much love? You need to stand at the feet of Jesus. His grace is sufficient. His grace covers all of your sins and mine, not just on the day of salvation, but every day. Every day. And that's why we can declare amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I'm seeing. Through many dangers and toils and snares, I've already come. Grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. I encourage you to come to the Savior's feet. He will forgive you of all of your sins. If you know how much you've been forgiven, then you will love much. Do you love the Lord?
I love Jesus.
Do you love the Lord?
I worship.
Do you love Him? You worship Him. He has forgiven you much. Sit and think where He brought you from. What He brought you through. Think about all those relationships that you've been involved in, and He saved you. He kept you. He preserved you. He's forgiven you much. Love Him much.
Lord,
have mercy. Lord, I love You more than anything. I worship You, Lord. I worship You, Lord. Do You love Him? Do You really, 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 really love Him? You got to understand that love is unconditional. Love is sacrificial. Love is visible. God loved us, and while we were yet sinners, He died for us. Do you worship Him? I praise Him. I'm here to give Him glory. I'm here this morning to give Him praise. I'm here this morning to give Him the honor. He's been good to me. He's been good to me. He has been better to me than I've been to myself. He is worthy to be praised. He loved me when I didn't even love myself. I love You, Jesus, more than anything. More than anything. Our Father, we bow before You. Lord, we pray that You'll be honored, that You'll be glorified, and the devil will be terrified. There's someone here this morning, Lord, that is in a need to come to the feet of Jesus. Come right now, Lord, touch in the name of Jesus, that they will accept You by faith. And they would come and lay themselves on the altar and say, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. He has forgiven you much. Just look back over your life. And if it had not been for the Lord, who was on your side. Through danger seen and unseen, if it had not been for the Lord, who was on your side, you would have committed suicide. You'd have thrown in the towel. You would have hurt somebody else. But Jesus was standing there, speaking up for you. He's forgiven you much. Do you love him much? Maybe someone here this morning, and I ask that, are you saved? Do you want to be saved? Do you want to be made whole? Do you want to spend eternity with Jesus? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. There's only one way. There's only one truth. You have to choose. Choose you this day. Who you going to serve? Will it be God or will it be man? Choose you this day. The choice is yours. And I ask this. If you were to die right now, where would you spend eternity? There's only two places you're going to go. You either going to heaven or you going to hell. There's no in between. There's no purgatory. And if you're not sure, if you want to go to heaven, but you're not sure, come. Do not leave this place with an uncertainty. I'm not sure. You don't have to leave like that. I want to invite you to the table and sup with Jesus. As I said, if you want to be saved, he is there waiting for you. If there's someone here this morning, say, preacher, I want to be saved. I want to go to heaven. And I have to be honest with you, when I first received Christ, it wasn't so much but heaven, but I wanted to be where my great-grandmother was and is. I want to see her again. I want to see my great-grandfather. I want to see my mama. I want to see my loved ones. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Do you want to go? Do you want to be saved? I'll see you by the raising of your hand. I ain't trying to put you on blast. Yes, I see you. I see you. It's prayer time, church. It's prayer time. Let that boy raise his hand. He said he want to be saved. And this is how you're saved. The Bible said if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you are saved right now in the name of Jesus, brother. You are saved. If you repeat that, you're saved right now. Just repeat, Lord Jesus, here I am. I'm sorry, Lord, for the sins that I have committed. Clean me up, Lord. Wash me. Make me new. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sin. I believe that early third day Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. The church say amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you, nephew. So those you have accepted Christ, and you are saved, the first step to obedience to be baptized. So I asked, have you been baptized? That's the first step to obedience. And we will baptize you here. We'll baptize you here, nephew. That's the first step to obedience, that we are followers of Jesus. Jesus was baptized in the Jordan. So we are to be baptized, going in the water. So you can get with me, nephew, and we can talk. If you want to be baptized, I will baptize you. Amen. And then there may be someone here that is online. You're saying that you saved. You said that you have been baptized. But do you have a church home? Come to the house. Is Jesus in the house? Jesus in the house. You need a church home. You need a church. I'm going to say that you could go to some church and it makes you wonder, am I in the club? Is Jesus in here? So I make an appeal right now. Right now, I invite you to join People of Christ Missionary Baptist Church. You need to be under a covering of a pastor. The Bible said, not forsaking the assemblings of ourselves as others, that we come to encourage one another. These are some dangerous times, and we need some to stand by one another, to support one another, to encourage one another as we go through this walk of life. And if that is you, if you don't have a church home, I invite you to People of Christ Missionary Baptist Church. But understand this, we are not a perfect church. If you're looking for a perfect church, don't join this one. For real, for real. Why? Because I'm not a perfect pastor. But this, we serve a perfect God. Amen. 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 And if you're online, if you meet me at the service, with my lovely secretary, amen. We will receive you, get your information, amen. If you're online, live stream, you can reach us at area code 209-833-7258. Amen. Amen. God bless you. To God be the glory. Oh, y'all could do better than that. The Bible says that angels in heaven rejoice over one, and the one came today. God hears and answers prayers. Amen. Amen. And another reason that we could just keep on rejoicing, amen, that we have a member that came last week by Christian Experience. Amen. That come into this local assembly. Amen. Amen. Her name is Sister Mary McGill. Amen, somebody. Amen. She's going to be shy this morning. Don't want to stand up, but that's all right. Come on, stand up anyway, Sister Mary. You got Mary right there. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You know I love you. Amen. Amen. Got Mary Cotton and Sister Mary. Mary in there. Mary Cotton. Amen. Just joined recently. Amen. To God be the glory. Amen. Amen. Just another note. I want to thank God. We had church yesterday. Amen. We had a wonderful time. Amen. Thank God for the brotherhood. Amen. You should have been here. I'm not sure if it's going to be online or not, but you should have been here. We had a good time. We had some good physical food. Amen. Everybody talked about the cheesy grits. Amen. Hallelujah. We had a wonder. We had good physical food. We had good spiritual food. Reverend Gary, amen. I'm having a senior moment. Cooper, I'm having a senior moment. Gave us a word this morning. Hey, look, count it to my head, not my heart. Amen.
Amen. Getting old up here this morning. But we had a wonderful time. Amen. And we give God all the glory and honor. Amen. 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 To all the brotherhood. I just got to put in a plug for this young man. And I tell you, he has grown by leaps and bounds since I've been here. Amen. There was a time I would ask him to come to my office. He didn't want to come in my office. You're like, what's wrong with him? You know, like I'm going to bite or something, right? But he has grown in leaps and bounds, and God is using him tremendously. Amen? Amen. That's no other than the chairman of our deacon board. Amen. The president of the brotherhood. Amen. Brother John, Deacon John Williams. Amen. That, look, he's still hiding. That, in the shadows. Amen, in the shadows. Amen, hallelujah. Great brother. All now look, so I can hear, I can feel my, he even called my name. All the deacon, Art Smith, amen, come on, stand up. We have some great deacons here. Amen, amen, Deacon Boyd, amen, amen, amen. And another one laying in the cut. Deacon Green in the back, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I thank God for you, brothers. I really do. I thank God for you, brother. Pray for our deacons. Amen. Amen, amen. Somebody try to tell you something negative about our deacons, you tell them the devil is a lie. Amen. God bless. Amen. Let me move on. Amen. But thank each and every one of you for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Now, we're going to try something new. Your prayers have been heard. We're going to exit through the double doors. Oh, we're going to try this now. But we still, you'll be in after our benediction. You will be in the hands of the ushers. Amen. And they will usher you out. Please try not to congregate in the vestibule, amen. We want to get some fresh air, amen. But please, I think the basket is out there. Amen, somebody. Just in case, amen, you might want to start tithing. You might want to give an offering. The basket is out there. The hand sanitizer is still out there, amen. God bless. And again, I thank all our visitors, amen. We thank you for blessing us with your presence. May we stand for our benediction, please. Amen. And after our benediction, I would ask if you would please be seated and you'll be in the hands of the ushers. Amen. Amen. What? Nothing? Me and the wife, we still trying to work it out. She give me these hand signals. Let's look unto the hills for which cometh our help. Our help cometh from the Lord, who created heaven and earth. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be both glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. May we all say, amen. You may be seated. I want to thank those that invited somebody to church. Thank you, Brother Walls. Amen, amen. We got some cards. Invite somebody. Amen. You might get a prize. I said you might. Invite somebody. Tell them Jesus is in the house.